So one of the biggest changes in math education is moving from that type of teaching that is the listen to my directions and follow these steps on every problem after the ones I give you, to a type of teaching math that is more about letting kids kind of use their own thinking processes to come up with answers to the problems. But this is a really hard change. That's why I call myself the recovering traditionalist, because I was that traditional type of teacher, that it was, here's the steps you need to follow, now go follow them, and if you don't understand those or can't remember them, then I would repeat them to you, typically slower and one-on-one, you know, maybe louder. You know, I was seriously that teacher. So one of the ways that we can start to make a change and is by allowing that student thinking, letting kids really solve problems in their own way. But one of the hardest ways to one of the things that's the most challenging, I guess, about this is changing the way that we actually grade what they're giving us. So we might feel okay with letting kids solve it any way they want, but then sometimes when they have to turn stuff in, that doesn't come across so well. My dad loves to tell the story. My dad just turned 70, so like this was a long time ago. But unfortunately, it still kind of happens. My dad loves telling the story about when he was in junior high and he had solved, you know, a whole worksheet full of problems. You know, it wasn't worksheets back then, but you get the picture, a whole bunch of problems. And the teacher marked every single one of them wrong. Every single one of them wrong. Yet the answers were correct. The reason he got them wrong was because he didn't solve it. His work wasn't showing the way that the teacher had shown in class. He didn't solve it the way that the teacher wanted, and so she marked them all wrong. And we would like to think that we aren't that teacher. I know I was that teacher. I was that teacher. And sometimes I still want to be that person too, even with my own kids. I'm like, no, that's not the way you should do it. And it's hard, it's especially hard because our textbooks aren't helping us out, you guys. With this shift in helping kids to use different strategies and solve problems these different ways, textbooks will do things like solve this using a number bond. Well, that really is just like my dad's teacher saying it had to be done the way that they showed in class. If we are still having kids have to show it a certain way, that is not allowing kids to be showing their own thinking processes. Now, I get that we want to expose kids to different models and strategies, and I'm totally fine with that. But if a kid wants to solve it another way, that should be allowed and even encouraged in the classroom. And inside of the Build Math Minds Facebook group, we have had a few recent posts that show how some teachers are kind of just following what a textbook says instead of allowing student thinking in the work. Now, I know that these posts, and I'm going to share them here in a moment, I know these posts don't mean that every teacher out there is doing this kind of stuff, but these posts brought up an opportunity for all of us to reflect upon how much we're allowing the textbook to dictate our students' strategies and how much we're allowing our students to dictate their own strategies. And so one of the first ones here, let me see if I can get it switched over. Okay. So Tina had posted this and asked, why is number two wrong? What is wrong with this? Because the kid gets it right. It says there are 10 bees. Some bees fly away. Then there are 6 bees left. How many bees flew away? And the kid writes 10 minus 4 equals 6. 4 bees flew away. But in the teacher notes up there, it says they underlined the 10 bees and the 6 bees, and they said 2 parts you know, and wrote the equation 10 minus 6 equals 4, meaning that the kid should have taken the numbers that were in that problem, the 10 and the 6, pulled them out, and then subtracted those. And so, but the kid didn't. And the hard part is because the textbook, I bet, in the answer key for that worksheet, it does say 10 minus 6 equals 4. and that we think like the answer has to be after the equal sign. The cool part about this kid is that they are making sense of the actual problem. The problem does make you want to take 10, subtract something, so that there are 6 left. That's what this problem is asking. But the textbook wants it set up a certain way. And that's what I want to encourage you guys to be able to look at and say, oh man, okay, is this looking at just getting an answer? Or are we actually looking at whether or not a kid is being a flexible problem solver and still got the correct answer? That's what we want to encourage our students to be able to do. We want kids to be flexible thinkers in math, right? That's what Build Math Minds is all about, is encouraging that flexible thinking and building our students' math minds. But sometimes our textbooks want to like say, nope, this is the way you have to do it. But that's not what teaching mathematics should be like anymore. It can be like that. I know we learned that way, but if you haven't heard me say it before, this is how I kind of relate it, is that I learned arithmetic. I learned how to compute mathematical problems. I did not learn mathematics. I didn't learn to be a thinker. And if we want to help our students be thinkers, then we've got to be able to allow them to solve a problem that makes sense to them in their way, even if that's not the way that the textbook says it should be done. And I know that it's been really difficult because all of this change with the new math and reform textbooks say, we're going to solve it this way, and then this way, and then this way. And again, that's just like the story with my dad. If we're not solving it this way, it's going to be wrong. Doesn't matter if you got the right answer, it's going to be wrong if it's not solved the way that the textbook has us do it. All right, so here's another example too from a textbook. Let me see if I can bring this one up. Okay, so this one was kind of a lengthy post from Melissa, but Melissa, I believe Melissa and I forgot to double check this. I think in the comments you said you were tutoring this kid, I believe. But again, there's like 100+ comments on this post and it's hard to get through them all. So Melissa had talked about how she was helping a student work through this problem and they had made this great list. They're trying to find all of the numbers that can be formed that are under 100 using the 4, 6, and the 1, and the 3. And the kid got marked as incorrect because they had put in the single digit number. I'm totally moving my cursor there. I don't know if it's even showing up on your end. But they're in problem number 1 in the red, they got that marked wrong because they used single digit numbers. They created single digit numbers. And then down below, the same thing is that they had a single digit number of 6, and that was counted as incorrect, even though 6 is in the ones place, right? So a lot of the commenting that was happening inside of the group was just talking about how it's just such a poorly written problem. It is not clear that it needs to be 2 digits. Like we could assume that, you know, because it says you have to form a number, you have to use 2 digits. But this is first grade, right? Like, I mean, come on, are they going to get it? I'm sure in the directions with the teacher that she might have said something like that. We want to form 2 digit numbers, not 1 digit numbers. But the whole idea again is, I'm going to switch back here so I can talk on screen. The whole idea again is that the textbook had the answer of, you know, whatever it was. And we tend to often look at that instead of looking at the thinking process that our students went through. So in the comments of that post, I did see a really good comment in there from Terry. And she had said, I'm kind of paraphrasing here a little bit, but I wanted to have it here so I could look and see. And she said, that's why she loves it when students share their work and their thinking, because it's an opportunity to reveal any blind spots to different interpretations. So by allowing students to share their thinking in math, not only do we get to see how kids might approach a problem, but it helps us reveal how problems can be interpreted differently by different people. We might write something, or our textbook writes something, assuming something about our students. But then once they actually dig in and start solving it, we realize my students aren't seeing it that way. And I just want to encourage you that it's okay to not do what your textbook says. When you see things like that and you see kids having great thinking, it is awesome and go with it. It is okay. As a parting thought, I want to remind you that here in the United States, at least, we have our math content standards that basically those are what tell you what types of math content kids need to learn at each grade level. Like, what are the standards at first grade, second grade, third grade, so on. But here in the United States, we also have our math practice standards. And these practice standards tell us how kids should interact and engage with that math content. So if you're not familiar with those, let me just bring that up really quick. So I know that not every state is a Common Core state, and I don't agree with everything that is in Common Core, but one thing I do love about the Common Core standards, I'm going to flip through to the pages right here. Starting on page 6 of the Common Core standards are the standards for mathematical practice. I call these the math practice standards sometimes too, but it's the same thing. There are 8 of them that we need to be making sure that we are helping our kids do these things as they are also doing their content standards. But it's things like when kids are doing addition and subtraction, if your standard is on add and subtract within 20, we want kids to make sense of problems and persevere when solving them. So it's not enough to just have kids be adding and subtracting. That is creating calculators. If we want to create kids who are building their math minds and engaging with mathematics, we need to also be making sure that they are doing and engaging in these 8 math practice standards. So if you don't know these, and even if you're not in the United States, these 8 things are 8 wonderful things to be using and making sure that your students are doing these things throughout their interactions with mathematics. So I'm trying to bring my notes back up so I can make sure that we hit our final points. But if you look at those 2 examples of work that I had shown earlier, those students were engaging in math practice standards. They were making sense of problems and persevering when solving them. They were reasoning abstractly and quantitatively. They were looking for and making use of structure. So yes, kids do need to be getting correct answers when they're solving problems in math, but we also want them engaging in those math practice standards while they work on problems. It isn't just about following what our textbook says needs to be done. Building math minds is really about students being able to think through and solve problems in a way that makes sense to them, even if it isn't the way that we would do it or the way that the textbook wants them to do it. All right. Now, I know that sounds easier than it is to put into practice, but there are little ways that you can do that just by, when you're grading stuff, looking at their process works, even if it doesn't align with the way that your book does it. If the book says, solve this using a number bond, it's okay to cross out number bond and just say, solve this any way that you want. All right, I hope that this has helped you build your math mind so you can build the math minds of your students, because that's what we're all here for.